Hey everyone, welcome to the session by Intellipaat. In today's world, we generate terabytes worth of data every single hour. Handling data, especially unstructured data like images, videos, and much more, is a very challenging task for the database technologies of today. And in this session, we're going to compare SQL head-on with MongoDB. Well, before we begin with the session, make sure to subscribe to the Intellipaat's YouTube channel and hit that bell icon so that you never miss an update from us. So here's the agenda for today. We'll start out by taking a quick introduction to databases. Followed by this, we can take an introduction to what SQL is as well. And after this, we're going to check out what MongoDB is and where MongoDB is used. And finally, we're going to compare SQL with MongoDB head-on to see what it has to offer to us. And guys, if you have any queries, make sure to head down to the comment section below and do let us know there, and we'll be happy to help you at the earliest. And if you guys are looking for end-to-end course certification in the latest database technologies, Intellipaat provides the latest and the trending courses in the same. So make sure to check it out. And on that note, let's begin the class. So coming to the first item on the agenda, we'll have a quick introduction to SQL. Well, what is SQL? Guys, SQL stands for Structured Query Language, and it is one of the standard languages which is used for accessing and manipulating relational databases. But then when we have to talk about the overall scope or the overall goal of the language such as SQL, well, it has a very simple goal. So the goal of SQL is actually very simple. It is to make sure that it gives the user a very easy way, a simple way, yet a powerful way to access the data while storing it and working along with it at the same time. So when we have to talk about how SQL is used, well, you know, SQL is basically used with a lot of data sets to actually store and work with the data. So all this data has to be generated, right? So step one to working with any databases is to make sure that it actually has the data. So after the data has been generated, it gets queried using SQL. So querying is the process where the programmer types in SQL queries, which basically, you know, is used to create a database, create a table, alter the table contents, and in fact even delete all of the contents as well. So there are multiple queries out there. But it has to be known that everything from the most simplest query all the way till very complex queries are actually very powerful in the world of SQL. You know, data can eventually be stored in a very structured way, and it can be accessed very easily and very nicely just because of SQL. It ensures that, you know, the data can be worked on at effective pace. So when we have to talk about a quick introduction to MongoDB, well, MongoDB is, you know, one of the world's best NoSQL database is what I've read. So coming to a quick talk about NoSQL, well, NoSQL is basically a non-relational database management system. So here the data is not interrelated to each other. It does not have a fixed schema. You know, there are concepts such as joins, which doesn't work. But at the end of the day, a NoSQL database can be spread across multiple systems, and, you know, it can be scaled in a very rapid pace. So this is one of the reasons why, in fact, NoSQL has gained so much traction in today's world. It is used by a variety of sources for any distributed data storage needs, and if there is a need for any huge data storage requirement at the same time. So, you know, when we talk about NoSQL, it actually means not only SQL or not SQL. But then it has come to a stage where people start calling it NoSQL, and pretty much that's the trend which has been set for the last couple of years, and we're going to call it NoSQL. So, coming to a quick introduction to MongoDB again, as we mentioned, MongoDB is a general purpose document based and, in fact, distributed database which is actually built for all of the modern developers to use. And eventually it has been put together in such a nice way that, you know, you can move your entire databases to the cloud and take your entire business and scale it up as well. So to come back to NoSQL a little bit, you know, NoSQL databases, it contains a wide variety of technologies which basically can store any type of data that you give it. You know, the variety of data, it can include structured data, for example, tables. It can include semi-structured data, unstructured data, for example, you know, images, videos, music, even polymorphic data as well. So, you know, when we talk about the companies which go on to use MongoDB, especially we have Twitter, we have Facebook, we have Google, and there are multiple other Fortune 500 companies which make use of NoSQL technologies on a day-to-day basis. But then the MongoDB usage, pretty much this is what the people at MongoDB say. They say it's been used by millions of developers to power the world's most innovative products and services. And in fact, what they say is actually true. People at Facebook, Envision, eBay, Adobe, Google, Squarespace, Sega, the gaming company, eHarmony, UK's government, all the way to
SAP. So all of the big companies pretty much go on to use a MongoDB.
Just a quick info, in case you guys are looking for end-to-end core certification in database technologies, Intellipaat provides the latest and the trending courses where you can learn all of these concepts thoroughly and earn a certificate at the same time. The link is given in the description box, so make sure to check it out. And on that note, let's get back to the class.
And in fact, coming to the quick comparison we're going to have between SQL and MongoDB, which is going to start right now with the first point, which is the meaning. Well, with the meaning, when we have to talk about it, you know, SQL databases actually involve handling a lot of data by making use of a model, what we call as the relational model. And this relational model makes sure that the data is related to one another and, you know, it can be accessed and worked along in a very simple manner. And this goes for the same when we have to talk about storing the data and, you know, processing the data at the same time. But then when you have to talk about MongoDB, MongoDB actually makes use of a non-relational database. So a non-relational database is usually document-based database where, you know, the data is actually not interlinked to each other. And this is how basically it works when we have to talk about MongoDB versus SQL. Then coming to the second point, it is the languages which are supported. So, you know, SQL is actually the primary language when we have to work with any relational databases, you know. There are multiple flavors of SQL that moves around. There's Microsoft SQL, Oracle SQL and many others. So all of these are, you know, varieties of the same base foundational concept of SQL. But then when we come to MongoDB, you know, MongoDB actually supports querying in JSON, where all the data is stored. There are actually two formats in which it is stored, JSON and BSON. And this is mostly used to work with the data indirectly and directly as well. So coming to the third point, we have data storage. In data storage, well, as I told you, SQL actually involves storing data in databases by making use of tables, by making use of interlinked storage methodologies. But then with respect to MongoDB, since it's a NoSQL database, it's going to store the data as key value pairs and collection based databases. So this is one of the most important differences when we have to talk about SQL and in fact MongoDB at the same time. So coming to the next point, which is foreign key. So, you know, SQL actually makes use of keys to map each table to another, or say, for example, a column to another column in another table. So when we have to map values from one table to another table, we use something called as keys. You know, we have primary keys, we have candidate keys, we have foreign keys and much more. So SQL actually supports making use of these foreign keys for various database operations when you have to talk about it. Well, when you have to come to talk about MongoDB, well, MongoDB does not support the use of foreign keys when you have to talk about storing data in databases. Then point number five, it's trigger support. So SQL ensures that there is a valid support when we have to make use of triggers, because triggers, again, at the end of the day are, you know, a special type of stored procedure which will automatically run whenever an event occurs when we have to talk about the SQL server or wherever the database has been stored. So these triggers keep running and they run a procedure for us, which pretty much is already ready to execute, and in fact it has already been compiled. But then when we have to talk about MongoDB, MongoDB actually does not allow the users, does not allow the flexibility of making use of procedures, you know, stored procedures and triggers. And coming to number six, it's schema. Well, again, SQL databases contains a predefined schema which ensures the user can work with a fundamental structured data. But then MongoDB actually does not contain a structured predefined schema. It goes on with a dynamic schema, and this dynamic schema has been the gold standard of working when we have to talk about all of the big NoSQL databases present today. And then coming to point number seven is the best fit. You know, sometimes SQL is not the best fit when we have to talk about hierarchical data storage, because again, storing data one after the other, where it might become cumbersome and inefficient to go on to work with it after some point of time. But then MongoDB shines here, because, you know, MongoDB in fact is one of the best fit when you have to talk about hierarchical data storage methodologies. Coming to number eight, it's scalability. Again, SQL databases can be scaled vertically on top of another, just like a stack, just by increasing the RAM of the system. But then when we talk about MongoDB, MongoDB databases can actually be scaled horizontally by adding more servers in parallel to each other. Again, the outcome of this difference actually differs from what your company wants, because vertical scalability is something which is required at one point of time in an organization, while horizontal stability and, you know, scalability is required by adding more servers to ensure, you know, redundancy is controlled, the data is there data backups and the data can be accessed quicker than usual. So again, coming to a quick comparison in this scalability point, each of these has a stand, but then we had to mention this point because SQL is known for vertical scalability and MongoDB is known for horizontal scalability. Coming to point 9, it's the basic working. While SQL emphasizes on certain properties we call as the ACID properties, A stands for atomicity, C for consistency, I for isolation, and D for durability. So the entire basis of SQL is based on these properties to make sure that the database is relevant and easy to work with, and at the same time very low in redundancy as well. But then when we talk about MongoDB, MongoDB, you know, goes on to use something called as the CAP theorem. C stands for consistency, A stands for availability, and P for partition tolerance. So all of these again are the driving force behind MongoDB and SQL, ACID for SQL and CAP theorem for MongoDB. And each of these points, when we have to talk about it, adds a certain uniqueness, adds certain value to the entirety of the theorem and eventually the working of the database as a whole. Then coming to point number 10, it's external support. As we already know, SQL has been there for a while now and that it has excellent support, because every time there is an SQL provider out there, there are many vendors out there who provide support for this, because at the end of the day, SQL, as I told you, there are multiple flavors which can be accessed through, which can be worked with, and at the same time all of these flavors are about 70-80% the very same. So if you come to know one of the flavors of SQL, it'll be very easy to adapt and learn the other thing as well. So it has excellent support when it comes to this. Then coming to MongoDB, MongoDB actually has good support too, because when you have to talk about it, MongoDB entirely, you know, relies on the community support, and in fact it gets amazing community support, and this is the entirety and this is the center of universe when we have to depend on good support structures with respect to MongoDB, because at the end of the day, the community guidelines, the how the community grows out the product and helps people out is what makes MongoDB what it is. So to summarize this quick comparison between SQL and MongoDB, you know, SQL has been a major player throughout the world of IT, right? It has been very vital, and some people call it legacy as well. In fact, I would disagree with that statement, because if it was something, if it was a legacy application, then it would have totally not been adopted every single time there's a requirement for a relational database. But then when you have to talk about it, the ground reality is that both SQL and NoSQL databases have been there alongside each other in many companies as well. And then coming to MongoDB, you know, MongoDB brings about a very different variety, a very different idea and perspective of storing the data and eventually letting the user work with the data in a very simple manner, in a very effective manner, without much querying, and you know, it makes it very intuitive to work with the database at the same time as well. So what's your take on this? What do you think about SQL and what do you think about MongoDB? And with that thought, you've reached the end of this session.
Just a quick info, in case you guys are looking for end-to-end core certification in database technologies, Intellipaat provides the latest and the trending courses where you can learn all of these concepts thoroughly and earn a certificate at the same time. The link is given in the description box, so make sure to check it out. I hope this session was very informative for you all. In case if you have any more points you want to add to this SQL versus MongoDB video, or if you have any queries in general, make sure to head down to the comment section and do let us know. We'll be happy to help at the earliest. And on that note, have a nice day.